Well, good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us for today's competition. The three-minute thesis celebrates the exciting research conducted by PhD students. It was developed at the University of Queensland. The exercise cultivates students' academic, presentation, and research communication skills, something that's important regardless of the career trajectory that their students are on. The competition supports their capacity to effectively explain their research in 3 minutes in a language that's appropriate to a non-specialist audience. My name is Scott Lanyon. I'm Vice Provost and Dean of Graduate Education, and really thrilled that the graduate school can host this university-wide competition. Participants are permitted to use one static slide to explain their research in just 3 minutes. They're not allowed to use any additional props or media. A panel of judges, whom I will introduce in just a moment, will score each student to determine the winner. Students are judged on a number of criteria, including comprehension of the research, presentation of the content in a way that's accessible to a general audience, engagement of the audience, a little difficult in a Zoom environment, and enthusiasm for the subject and communication skills. During the past year, a number of our colleges within the University of Minnesota held their own collegiate three-minute thesis competitions. And today's participants are the winners of those competitions, representing five different colleges in a very diverse field of study. Three prizes will be awarded today: the People's Choice Award of $150, more about that later. Second prize is $250, and the first prize is $500. In addition, the first place winner will represent the University of Minnesota at the Midwest Association of Graduate Schools three-minute thesis competition next spring. Just some word about the etiquette here, brief reminder. Keep yourself muted unless you're actually presenting. Please we're recommending that attendees use the select side-by-side shared screen and speaker for their view. If you have questions or concerns, please chat Kate Sawada or Anna Nowak. And there is a PDF of the program available, which includes participant bios and more information about the event. And it's here on your screen. And I think Kate is also shared it via chat. So I encourage you to take a look at that as well. With that, let's introduce our judges, a very important component to this competition. And I've asked each judge to introduce themselves, to explain a little bit about their interest in being part of the three-minute thesis competition, and generally their view on the importance of developing effective communication skills. So to start, Catherine Crawford Luber, Director and President, Minneapolis Institute of Art. Catherine?
Well, hello, good afternoon, good morning to all of you, and I'm so honored to be invited to be a judge of this wonderful program. I'm a recent new resident of the Twin Cities. I've just been here at the Minneapolis Institute of Art a little bit less than a year now, so getting used to my real first whole winter. But I feel like it's such an important opportunity for the students at the university to have this chance to present their research in this way, because these are the skills that become the building blocks for success in future careers. So I'd love to also congratulate each of the presenters today for their hard work, for their drive, for their being able to put this together and present such important work in such a short amount of time. And I want to thank also Dean Lanyon for being supportive of this work for the students, because I think it's so important. Anyway, I'm looking forward to hearing all about you all and learning more about your presentation. So thank you again for including me.
Thank you. And welcome to the Twin Cities. As a former museum director myself, welcome to the museum community. It's a great community.
Thank you. It is a great community, and it's the Twin Cities community is one that is offers so many riches in terms of cultural opportunities. And
yeah. Great, thank you. Our next judge is Dr. Joko Farah, Chief Information Officer and Chief Quality Officer for the People's Center Clinics and Services. Dr. Farah.
Yeah, good morning, everyone. I'm honored and humbled to be amongst you, and I look forward to hearing all the great presentations and the work that you've been doing the last several years, especially in these unprecedented times. So I congratulate you on what you've been able to produce. I am a physician by training, and I oversee sort of the population health and care delivery system for a network of community health centers here in Minneapolis. And so I'll just leave it at that. Look forward to learning more about each and every one of you and the projects and the things that you'd like to pursue moving forward, and help understanding a little bit more about where you want this to take you in the next foreseeable future. So good luck, and you will do great. Take a deep breath. this is an elevator pitch, essentially. So look forward to hearing your work. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, Kelly Eileen Herr. This is Regent Herr is a member of our Board of Regents. She's also Chief Executive Officer of the Hmong Elders Center. Regent Herr. Regent Herr, you're still muted. There you go.
Okay. Good morning. Good morning. I'm Kelly Eileen Herr. I'm regent of the University of Minnesota. It's my pleasure and privilege to be a part of this 3MT competition. I just want to really underscore how important this competition is and what it means and the challenge that it gives to the students. I think that as we all work, we become so specialized, we become so focused that we forget who in fact we are serving. And so the idea and the challenge of asking to ask the presenters to really think about how they can communicate what they're doing in one slide, in a 3 minute to get to the heart of what you're doing. I think it's a question that, or a challenge that we all should be asked and should be challenged to provide answers for, I think will allow us to focus on our work and on ourselves. So I think this competition is perfect for me, being a content person and the total outsider. So I'm looking forward to learning. I'm looking forward to all the presenters. So congratulations to getting to this point. And I look forward to a fierce and hopefully, as last year, entertaining and informative competition. So my pleasure to be here.
Thank you very much. Next, we have Thor Hong, International Relations Analyst from the U.S. Department of Labor.
Thank you, Dr. Lanyon. Good morning, everybody. I'm excited to be here today, and it's a great honor to be part of this distinguished judges panel. I want to just congratulate all the presenters on all the hard work that you've all put in your projects. It wasn't too long ago I was at the Humphrey School there in Minneapolis, and so I know the grind that you're all going through, and I'm just looking forward to learning what you've all been researching. Effective communication skills are definitely essential in most professions. I know you're all coming from different parts of the university. I would just say, you know, if you can write well and you can speak well, that's a great foundation for your professional life, and it can open doors for you. I would just say, you know, always push yourself and challenge yourself. You know, you're already doing that just even being part of this competition. So just always push yourself to get better, because, you know, you probably already know giving a presentation isn't just an academic thing. It's something that you'll constantly, you know, be doing in various ways throughout the rest of your professional life. So thank you, and looking forward to all the presentations.
And our fifth judge is Dr. Josephine Martin, Senior Manager, International Regulatory Affairs, CFIT. Dr. Martin.
Good morning. Thank you for having me as a judge. I really look forward to the competition and hearing everyone's thesis projects explained. Congrats right now on your accomplishment. I know it's taken a lot to do the research that you have done to lead up to today. So I really want to congratulate you on that. Getting to this point in your academic career is very laudable. So keep that in mind. And even though there are certain status after this competition of winners, you are all winners for at least coming up to this competition, stepping up to the plate and making it this far. So really congratulate yourselves for that. When it comes to communication, like the other judges stated, it is very key to be able to not only write, but also have very clear communication skills and verbal skills. That will take you a long way. There are a lot of opportunities after this competition that could also help along the way, such as Toastmasters International, which I've been a part of and an avid cheerleader for. So if you're not familiar with Toastmasters, definitely I would implore that you get to know your local chapters there and look to join. It's a very fun way to hone your communication skills further. And with that, I will not stand in the way for the competition. Looking forward to hearing everyone. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much. So I mentioned that there's a People's Choice Award. So I just wanted to make sure that you're all thinking about that as we're going into these presentations. Each of you who are attending today will have an opportunity to vote for your favorite presenter via Zoom poll after all the students have presented. So keep that in mind as you're listening to these presentations. So with that, I'm gonna introduce each contestant. We're going to put up your first slide, your title slide. I ask that the contestants actually state when they are ready so that we start their presentation slide and start the timer. Our first presenter is Sloan Okri Anderson. Her title, Faithful Affirmation, a study of LGBT adults and their relationship with Christian parents. Sloan.
All right, I'm ready. Mom, Dad, I'm gay. This is what we picture, isn't it? When we think about coming out, we picture an anxious teenager blurting out his truth at the dinner table. And Mom and Dad react either with immediate acceptance or complete and often biblical rejection. It's true that religious affiliation predicts the rejection of LGBT offspring, but over the last decade, research has begun to demonstrate that parental reactions to disclosure are often a lot more ambiguous than this acceptance-rejection binary, even in highly religious families. An emerging theme in the research is that parental reactions to disclosure are often immediately negative, but that negativity decreases over time and family relationships improve, even in families where mom and dad don't change their religious opinions about LGBT identity. But what does improved really mean? For my dissertation, I'm conducting qualitative interviews with LGBT adults who were raised in non-affirming Christian families, and I'm finding that improved does not always mean good. Participants described cordial relationships with their families, but parental religious beliefs still caused tensions, hurts, and divisions. Participants were often asked to remain closeted in front of certain family members. Some parents refused to attend weddings or engagements, and others pretended that their child never came out in the first place. Each of these polite rejections chipped away at the parent-child relationship. So, although things were decidedly improved from the initial negative reaction, the long-term absence of acceptance resulted in decreased emotional closeness, leaving participants wondering if they were even members of their own families. So, why does this matter? Well, nearly half of American Christians, that's around 50 million households, believe that LGBT identity is not compatible with Christian faith. Faced with this conflict, Christian parents are often advised to love the sinner but hate the sin. Remain cordial, but don't change your mind. While this is certainly an improvement upon outright rejection, improved does not always mean good. My research demonstrates that this approach can lead to painful relational ambiguity and declining mental health. When it comes to family belonging, affirmation is just as important as love. These findings suggest that researchers should attend to relational ambiguity when studying LGBT family relationships, Additionally, mental health practitioners should understand and normalize these ambiguous types of relationships so that LGBT people can find the support that they need. Finally, this suggests that we need faith-informed outreach to help Christian families with LGBT offspring join the 54% of American Christians who have found a way to practice both faith and affirmation.
Thank you very much. We will take just a little time here for the judges to make their notes. I want to remind judges, when you are ready for the next presentation, please click the yes button on the participant panel so that we can see that we're ready to proceed. Our next presenter is Jessica Deer from the College of Veterinary Medicine. Fish as Indicators of Ecosystem Health, Assessing the Impact of Contaminants of Emerging Concern. Jessica.
Okay, I'm ready. Hi, everyone. The picture you see here is of Trout Lake, a lake in the remote, undeveloped wilderness on the Grand Portage Reservation, where the Grand Portage Band of Lake Superior Chippewa, a Native American population in northeastern Minnesota, reside. Grand Portage tribal members rely heavily on subsistence fish species in this area. Would you believe it if I told you that we detected an antibiotic, antidepressant, stimulant, steroid hormone, and insect repellent in this lake that has no human development along its shoreline? Well, we did. Sure, we only detected 5 contaminants and at relatively low concentrations, but does this mean we should simply dismiss this as only a small problem? How concerned should we be? This is what my thesis work is aiming to discover. Our team is investigating contaminants of emerging concern, which are chemicals that were previously unknown, unrecognized, or unregulated in aquatic ecosystems here in Minnesota. The chemicals that we tested for contain pharmaceuticals and personal care products. So everything from the antibiotics prescribed to humans and animals to the insect repellent that we use when we're out fishing in and exploring near these lakes. We are assessing whether there are differences in the occurrence of contaminants in fish, water, and sediment across environments that are exposed to varying levels of human impact, which we categorized as water bodies with human development along the shoreline, those with no human development, and those directly impacted by wastewater effluent. Then we're taking it a step further and quantifying the health effects that these contaminants have on subsistence fish species in these lakes. Of the 158 contaminants that we tested for, we detected 117 in water, fish, and/or sediment. And as you can see in the Venn diagram displayed on the right, 102 contaminants were detected in water, 67 in sediment, and 35 in fish. And 15 of those contaminants were found in all 3 sample types, and include chemicals such as insect repellent, antidepressants, antibiotics, and other pharmaceuticals, caffeine, and even cocaine. Our team also performed health assessments on fish collected from these lakes so that we can determine the association between fish health and contamination. And diagnostic tools developed through this project may be used to objectively evaluate the health of fish populations exposed to environmental contaminants in any aquatic system. Understanding the potential threats that these contaminants have on fish health will not only inform management of aquatic systems, but will also reveal pressing environmental contaminants for remediation and potential food safety and security threats to the tribal community in northeastern Minnesota. Thanks for listening.
Thank you very much. All right, we are set to proceed. Our next presenter is Persephone Ma. Sewage sludge incinerator ash as a recycled phosphorus source. Persephone.
I'm ready. Hi, everyone. I want to speak with you about 3 seemingly separate issues. 1, the UN projects that we will have 9.7 billion people by the year 2050. That's a lot of people to feed. 2, we have about 300 years left of known phosphorus reserves. Phosphorus is a mined and pretty much non-renewable resource, but it's essential for all life, especially as a nutrient for crops. 3, in the US, we produce 15 billion pounds of dried sewage every year. It's a lot of sewage. But what if I told you that that sewage had a lot of phosphorus in it? In my PhD, I want to see if we can take that sewage after it's been incinerated and use it as a phosphorus source to grow more food. We have 3 questions. 1, does it work? Yes or no? Okay, if it does work, then 2, how well does it work? And the question on everyone's mind, three, is it safe? Right now in the US, sewage sludge incinerator ash is sent to landfills where the phosphorus is just lost forever. In St. Paul alone, we throw away 3.5 million pounds of phosphorus this way every year. While 300 years of phosphorus may seem like a long time, we have the opportunity right here, right now, to recycle phosphorus and be a model for cities around the globe. The Twin Cities looked into this several decades ago, but stopped when there were concerns about elevated metals. However, due to increased regulations, the concentrations of those contaminants have decreased significantly. And a recent greenhouse study showed that there's strong evidence that this ash would be a safe fertilizer. Fast forward a few decades, we wanted to know how this ash would perform in real life. We did a 3-year field study in corn and soybean and compared the ash that you see on your screen to a conventional phosphorus fertilizer and two other waste-based fertilizers down in Rosemont, Minnesota. Now, 3 years later from the start of that field study, I can tell you that our sewage sludge incinerator ash provides phosphorus for crops while applying minimal heavy metals to either the crops or the soil. While there may be a few more steps to full commercialization, these results tell us that our local St. Paul ash is a worthy substitute for mined phosphorus sources. This has major implications for the way that we use phosphorus. Instead of mining for phosphorus, we can take those 15 billion pounds of sewage and use the phosphorus that's already in there to extend the life of our phosphorus reserves and ensure that we're ready to feed those 9.7 billion people. Thanks for listening.
Thank you. Our next presenter is Yali Zhang. Nanometer-sized interconnect, joints and future communication circuits.
I'm ready. Hello, everyone. Did you know there are 206 bones, but only 78 joints in your body? Each joint is very important. They're used to link bones while reducing the friction of motion. Similarly, electronic interconnect plays a very important role in communication system. They provide transitions and connections for signal routing and system grounding. Just like joint, interconnect links different parts of a communication system while reducing the friction of signal movement. Unfortunately, the faster signal speed of 5G and higher generation application make their signal level very low. So the conventional interconnect with their high loss are ineffective. Can you run faster with stiff knees? The answer is no. My name is Yali Zhang. Let me tell you how we build a better electronic joint for future communication system, which requires lower power consumption and a faster operation speed. We propose to use bundles of nanowires to form one low-loss interconnect in communication integrated circuit. Each of these nanowires is extremely small, almost 1 over 300,000 diameter of one single human hair. The good thing is this extremely small size makes the high frequency signal easily to penetrate. Also, by bundling them together, a large number of current paths can be created, so the total power loss can be reduced. One important question that needs to be answered is how to determine the actual loss of these nanowires. Their size are small, so their associated signal level are low. To answer this question, my circuits are designed to increase the signal level of these nanowires. Similar to a doctor who used a stethoscope to check our tiny heartbeat sound, my circuits are designed to include 30 interconnect building blocks. And each block includes 200,000 nanowires to increase the signal level. So this nanometer size interconnect could be a game changer to future 5G and higher generation circuits. Someday, when you're enjoying the faster video streaming or virtual conferences without any latency, please remember, these little joints may support. Thank you.
All right. And our final presenter this morning is Ray Zhang, clearing blood vessel traffic to defeat Alzheimer's disease.
Before I start, I just want to make sure that everybody can hear me well and see me well.
We can see right. You and hear you.
Okay, thank you so much. I'm ready. All right, hello. I'd like to invite you all to take a second to think about the best moment in your life so far that you shared with your loved ones. Maybe it's your graduation day when you and your family took a group photo with you in a cap and gown and with them looking proud. Maybe it's when your first child was born and your family were finally allowed into the room to see the face of the new life for the first time. For me, it was the night when my cousin and I ate 3 12-inch pizza to celebrate my PhD admission, and we both got so sick the next day. Never done this ever again. Anyway, we cherish these individual moments that make up our lives, and we will expect our loved ones to cherish them as well. So imagine how we would feel if one day these memories in their mind, along with our faces, just suddenly faded away, no matter how hard they try to remember. This is Alzheimer's disease, a dementia that has become so devastating to families and to our entire society that by 2050, it's gonna affect 15 million Americans alone. But we still don't have a single effective treatment even now. And I wanna change that with my research. To simply explain the disease, imagine the blood vessels in the brains, they're like highways that normally get rid of the toxins, like these white cars, out of our brain. But suddenly one day these cars cannot even get into the highway in the first place because there's been an accident, a pileup on the ramp. So these black cars represent a toxic protein called amyloid in the Alzheimer's disease brain, and it accumulates along the blood vessels, causing traffic, preventing the toxins out of the brain and the nutrients we need into the brain, which will eventually cause the dying of our brain cells. So what should we do? I choose to borrow the power of our immune system. Our natural defense system has become so powerful and intricate during evolution to simply do its job. Think about it this way. The immune cells in our brains, they're like highways that are normally, the immune cells in our brains, they're like Pac-Man. They can literally devour this toxic protein that clear the traffic. And I'm using an experimental drug to further power these immune cells, clear the traffic, so we can get our nutrients into the brain and the toxins out of the brain, and hopefully restore the memory. Just picture what a profound moment that could be if one day your loved ones may remember and say your name for the first time in a decade. And I hope with the help of my research, we as a scientific community can bring some light into the darkness that is Alzheimer's. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much. All right, I think we're good to go. So first, I'd like to announce the results of the People's Choice polling. And the winner for the People's Choice is Ray Zhang, with his presentation, Clearing Blood Vessel Traffic to Defeat Alzheimer's Disease. Congratulations to Ray. The second place is awarded by the judges to Ray Zhang. Congratulations. And the first place winner awarded by the judges is Persephone Ma, with her research on sewage sludge incinerator ash as a recycled phosphorus source. Ray, would you like to say a few words?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much for all the organizers, for the judges, and for the people who are here to support me and to vote for me. And it was absolutely amazing experiences, and also to hear all the great contestants speak about their research, and they're so passionate about it. And everybody's doing a great job in terms of the research and presentation. So I feel greatly honored to receive this award. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Persephone, would you like to say a few words?
Sure. I don't know if I can be quite as eloquent as Ray, but I wanted to echo the same sentiments. Thank you, judges, to your time and to your thoughtfulness. Thank you, everyone who attended, for supporting everyone. Thank you so much to the other contestants who I've learned so much from. This was a nice little end of week bit of joy. And I hope that everyone has a wonderful weekend, and thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, all of the presenters. Thank you, judges, for your hard work. This is always a fun thing for judges, but also a difficult thing, I know. And to the audience, thank you for being here and providing support and for just participating in this great event. And I'd like to echo Persephone's comment. Have a great weekend. This is, for me, a great way to sort of roll out or end a week. And I appreciate everybody's involvement. And I really hope that you're all doing well. Stay safe, stay healthy, and enjoy life. Thank you.